Well, good morning, everybody. I'm Mike Marr. I'm the chairman of the Roman Sports Register, which is the oldest rugby club in the world. Others exist, John, so there we go. Right. Now, shortly we should be seeing some pictures.
Which one do you want on first?
The one on the man on the bike would be good.
No, that's not there.
Oh. Hang on.
Cycle
up.
Bear with me.
Technology. I think you're going to need to talk rather than...
Yes, okay, right, okay. Is it two jokes and a song time?
That's it.
Right. Okay. Well, the early history of Rover and this factory was all about bicycles. It all started up at West Orchard, which is not far away, in the 1880s. And by 1884, what we call the safety bicycle, you will know as a push bike, had developed. And it was selling like hot cakes. Alongside that, there were some other little interesting diversions, and I had hoped that we'd get to see a picture of it. In 1888, J.K. Starr and the company built an electric car, the first electric car in Coventry, perhaps not in the UK, but certainly in Coventry. The trouble was, at that time, the Locomotive Act was in force, the Red Flag Act. So that in order to use a locomotive on the streets, you had to have a man with a red flag walking in front of it, and you were limited to 2 miles an hour in town. 4 miles an hour in open countryside, wow. But not good. In order to test the vehicle to its full capabilities, it had to be taken to France, where they didn't have red flags or red flagmen. And it was tested in Dover and achieved 8 miles an hour, which would have put you in front of the beaks in the UK. Unfortunately, it didn't come to much because of the Red Flag Act and because the batteries were big, they were heavy, and the absolute range of that car was 20 miles an hour. So you'd have had to have a steam engine and generator every 20 miles to recharge your batteries. Now, who had that in the 1880s? Certainly, domestic electricity wasn't really in this country at that time. So that and the fact that the Rover safety bicycle was selling in very, very large numbers meant that it didn't proceed. But, you know, there are parallels, I think, with modern electric cars and charging points and range and all that sort of good stuff. Haven't moved on that much, have we, in electric traction? You might tell I'm a bit of an enthusiast in the internal combustion engine. Right, so we move on, and in 1904, there were a couple of significant developments. One was what's called we would know as a tri-car, so it had a motorcycle back end and a big seat on the front. It was available in air-cooled or water-cooled varieties, and that was certainly something that many people were enthused about. And because Rover had already been into motorcycles in a big way, the vehicle had a limited following. The first Rover car, as I'm sure we all know, because many of us have seen pictures of it outside the main entrance to the works, was an 8 horsepower in 1904. And it was designed by Edmund Lewis and was a fairly instant success, to the extent that people thought it rather overpowered. So a 6 horsepower car was designed for 1905. And that again took off. Now, the cars weren't made in large numbers in the early years, possibly 400 a year. But that consumed quite a lot of resource in this factory. So moving forward a little, with cycles as it happens, to 1908. Anybody who's worked in marketing will appreciate what product placement is. You ask for sponsorship from somebody on the basis they can put their product in your film or something. Well, it happened with the Olympics in 1908. For the first time, there were going to be cycling events at the White City, and the special track was actually laid around the periphery of the White City running track for cycles. There were 8 cycling events, one of which was cancelled for some reason, but of the remaining 7 resulted in 6 golds for Great Britain and a number of silvers and bronzes as well. There was 1 gold for the French, and all the cycles were built by Rover.
You've got your slides. Hey. Made a PowerPoint presentation.
Smashing. That's lovely. Thank you very much. That's an illustration of an early Rover cycle. There's also an illustration of an early Rover cycle frame, which you'll recognise as being typically diamond framed. That's from the late 1880s, but it's already got your typical bike frame. And the next one, I think, is that's the electric car. You can see in the wicker basket at the back, there were lots of other heavy batteries and tiller steering. But as I say, it achieved 8 miles an hour at Durham. Right, consult scripture. Okay, passing back to 1904. In 1905, the firm became the Rover Company. It had previously been the Rover Cycle Company. And in 1907, cars such as the 20 horsepower that we see outside, with the very distinctive radiator. That's the first time you see the shield shape in the radiator of a Rover car, and it's carried on ever since. In 1911, Owen Clegg designed a 12 horsepower car that was the company's mainstay for the next 10 years, interrupted of course by the Second World War, when Sunbeam vehicles were built under license by Rover, both in terms of staff cars and ambulances. After the war, production resumed with the Clegg Rover and a number of other models. In 1925, a Rover 1445 was built. It wasn't properly costed, so it didn't make the company any money, but it did win them the first of 5 Dewar trophies. Dewar Trophy was and is now for engineering excellence. Now, the first was the 50 consecutive ascents of Hellfire Pass in North Wales. And there is a Welsh name that I'm not going to attempt. But Hellfire Pass, North Wales, 50 consecutive ascents and descents in the 1445. Later, they produced a car called the 1650, which was basically a rework 1445, and that did make them some money. Right, I suppose I should actually mention that the second of the Dewar trophies was awarded in 1950 for Jet 1, which was a gas turbine powered vehicle. The gas turbine was driving the wheels and achieved a record of 151.977 miles an hour at the Dubiki Highway in Belgium, which is about the only flat stretch of road that wouldn't attract the attention of the British police for record attempts. And that record actually still stands. And there were another three Dewar trophies. Now, I'm going to have to unwind this crib sheet, so excuse me. We've talked about cycles, we've talked about motorcycles, every single thing has to come to an end. In 1925, the Rover Company moved on to full-time production of cars. So motorcycles came to an end, but bicycles did not. We know of a bicycle that was assembled from Rover parts that was used at Load Lane, up and down the production lines to take messages from one to the other. And it was built up, as I say, from Rover parts. So that is actually the last Rover bicycle made. It is still in existence, and it's a ladies' model, and is with, I would say, a prolific veteran cyclist. And she has used that car, her model, for over 50,000 miles with rallies across the continent and in the UK. I'm going to close with just a reminder that in 1930 there was a record attempt on the Blue Train. Blue Train ran from Saint Raphael in South France to Calais, and it was the way to travel. The Rover Company decided to set up a competition, and one of the motoring journalists at the time, Dudley Noble, and two others formed the crew of the Light 6 that was going to try and beat the Blue Train. Well, it did in the fourth attempt. This was December 1930, so much of the route was foggy and fog-bound, and on three attempts, it was either unsafe or there was an accident which took one of the wings off, so they had to stop and try again. It wasn't particularly surprising to those in the know, because the car, instead of the 2-litre engine that the Light 6 normally had, was fitted with a 2.5-litre engine. So there we go. J.K. Starley, John Kemp Starley, was a very good engineer, and so were his family. All of the first sons of the Starley family are John Kemp Starley. John Kemp Starley, 3rd, 4th, 5th, 6th. Bit of a problem with number 7. She was a girl. And Joanna Kemp Starley, 7th, is in fact an aeronautical engineer, so she's keeping the family tradition going. So there we are. That's a little bit about this factory, what was built in there, and thank you very much.